Wasaieti. Good morning. My name is Jacqueline Johnson Peda. I'm the Executive Director of the National Congress of American Indians, the oldest and largest Native American advocacy organization representing Indian Country and Alaska Natives and their broad interests of the tribal governments and their communities. I am also pleased to welcome our distinguished guests here in Washington, D.C., and those listening around the country to the 2013 State of Indian Nations. Across the country, students, teachers, and tribal citizens and leaders, businesses have gathered to watch this event together. Among those many events, we are pleased to be joined by students from the Laguna Middle School, the Mandry High School, the Boys and Girls Club of the Greater Scottsdale, and tribes like the Sisseton, Wahpeton, Oyate, Muscogee Creek Nation, the Confederated Tribes of Umatilla Reservation, and hosting viewing tribal parties and employees for their tribal offices are in many areas of the country. And we're also pleased to be joined by the College of the Menominee Nation, the Four Bands Community Fund, the American Indian College Fund. These are just a small selection of events that are happening today, and we want to thank them and thank all of you for joining us. We have an incredible turnout here in Washington, D.C., and I'd like to acknowledge some of our guests that are here in the studios with us this morning. From the administration, we have Jody Gillette and Charlie Galbraith from the White House, Dr. Yvette Rubidoux from IHS, Lillian Sparks from the Administration for Native Americans, and we also have representatives from key federal agencies that include the Department of Agriculture, Commerce, Homeland Security, Interior, Justice, Labor, and EPA. From the Capitol, we're delighted to be joined by Congresswoman Betty McCollum, David Mullen from the Senate Committee on Indian Affairs, and staff from Senators Bagage, Heitkamp, and Cantwell's office. We're also honored to be joined today by the head councilman, Joe Garcia, from Okeewingay, who is also on our board, as well as Larry Townsend, who's on our board from the Lumbee Tribe, and Vice President Joe Duke Poo from the Round Valley Tribe, Kevin Gover from the National Museum of American Indians, Byron Dorgan from the Center of Native American Youth, Clara Pratt from the Navajo Nation's Washington office, Kiki Carroll from the United Southern and Eastern Tribes, Chris McNeil from Sea Alaska Native Corporation, and Chairman Ernie Stevens, who, by the way, has never missed the State of Indian Nations, from NIGA, and from Stacy Boland from NIHB. We're also joined today by two Indigenous leaders from Australia, Nigel Brown and Nari Akit. And we'd like to thank them for joining with us. Today we also have some NCAI partners from outside of Indian Country. Dr. Alice Warner Menhorn from Kellogg Foundation, Judith Brown Dianis from the Advancement Project, Ralph Everett from the Joint Center of Political and Economic Studies. Well, as you can tell by all the red in the audience, today is Valentine's Day, and I am sure that after this event today, you will love tribal sovereignty more than you ever have before, and even when you first met. It's already been a great week in Washington for our tribal nations. On Tuesday, the Senate passed the Violence Against Women Act, reauthorizing more than three quarters of the U.S. Senate, approving the bill that included key provisions for Native women. And our victory is not just resonating in the United States. To many around the world, today is V-Day. Activists around the world will be hosting events as part of the 1 Billion Rising, a movement to end violence against women and girls. Finally, I want to thank Native Voice One and the many tribal and public radio stations across the country for airing today's address, bringing the State of Indian Nations to hundreds and thousands of people in Indian Country and beyond. And now it's my pleasure to introduce the President of the National Congress of American Indians, Jefferson Keel. President Keel is currently the Lieutenant Governor for the Chickasaw Nation of Oklahoma. He is a retired U.S. Army officer with over 20 years of active duty service and has translated that into a sense of duty into serving Indian Country and protecting and advancing our sovereignty. Over his two terms as president of NCAI, he has been a true statement for Indian Country. President Keel has met with the President of Obama, engaged with key members of the President's cabinet, and traveled overseas to educate foreign leaders about our unique nation-to-nation relationship. He has championed tribal health care, worked hard with the promise of the Tribal Law and Order Act, and led the charge for the most successful Native vote campaign ever. Ladies and gentlemen, please help me welcome the President of the National Congress of American Indians, Jefferson Keel.
Thank you. Thank you. Good morning. Members of the National Congress of American Indians, members of the administration, members of Congress, tribal leaders, fellow citizens, my fellow Americans. As president of the National Congress of American Indians, and as one of more than 5 million American Indians and Alaska Natives of the 566 federally recognized tribal nations and many state recognized governments of Indian country, it's an honor to speak to you today. Native Americans are as diverse as America itself, an array of cultures, each with its own rich heritage, its own proud history. In all of our vibrant threads, our stories and traditions, our struggles and triumphs are woven into the fabric of America. Every day, we're reminded of how far we've come and the great journey we have ahead of us. And though we've walked dark roads and overcome great challenges and tragedies, our future holds great promise. Today, Indian country is strong. I could not always stand here and tell you that. When I was a young boy growing up in southern Oklahoma, there weren't many opportunities in my Chickasaw community. My family, like many others, were poor, just barely scraping by. As soon as we were old enough, we started working, harvesting cotton, peanut, corn crops, piling hay onto trucks, hauling them to the barns. I saw neighbors working hard to build better lives for their families, parents and grandparents maintaining our culture, from traditional food, name-giving ceremonies, to celebrations of life and death, passing on the timeless values of our tribe. Even when the federal government told us we had no right to exist, we stayed true to ourselves. Still, times were tough. Our people sometimes wondered if our best days were behind us. But through it all, we carried on, forging new bonds with each other to strengthen our nations. NCAI was critical to this effort. In fact, that's why it was started in 1944, when tribal citizens and tribal leaders stood together to speak as one voice for America's tribal nations, to protect our sovereignty, to affirm our rightful constitutional place in the American family of governments. Their work to unify and mobilize tribes rippled through Indian country. My own community, like so many others, started to organize and advocate for our rights. And we committed ourselves to carrying on the vision of our fathers and mothers who signed the original treaties protecting tribal sovereignty. That vision guided us through a new era in tribal governance, self-determination, where tribal governments were once again able to run their own governments without interference. This new era was transformational. When I came home from Vietnam, I witnessed the optimism of leaders shaping their own community, the energy of people making their own decisions, the pride of a tribal nation unleashing its own potential. In many ways, my own experience and my tribe's experience reflect not just Indian country's advances, but our aspirations, that our communities might thrive in a modern global economy, that our children might achieve their dreams. And today, more than ever, those aspirations are within our reach. Thanks to a greater trust between tribal nations and the United States, we're in a moment of real possibility. In President Obama and his administration, we have a partner committed to strengthening tribal sovereignty, who believes in our right to determine our own course, who understands what we've always known to be true, that Indian nations are best governed by Indian people. This partisanship and partnership extends throughout the federal government on both sides of the aisle because Indian issues are not partisan issues. The result has had a meaningful, measurable impact on Indian people's lives. Today, more tribes are managing resources instead of managing poverty programs. Residents of rural Oklahoma drive to our health facilities first because they offer the best services around. Other governments seek our traditional knowledge of natural resources. Non-native people come to us for jobs and educational opportunities, and companies partner with us to set up new businesses on reservations. It's no wonder that more highly skilled and educated Native young people are coming back to serve in our communities as doctors, lawyers, teachers, engineers, entrepreneurs. And as we're revitalizing our own economies, tribes are becoming key players in America's economic recovery. My tribe, the Chickasaw Nation. The Chickasaw Nation contributes $2.5 billion to our regional economy every year and employs over 12,000 people. At the same time, we're taking a proactive approach to budgeting and stewardship so that we are more resilient. The nation-to-nation relationship we enjoy as tribal nations has never been confined to the borders of the United States. And thanks to more international trade agreements developed by tribal leaders, our businesses and many of those other tribes reach all around the globe. At the same time, our people's dedication to America has never been stronger. Last year, I stood at this podium and called for Native Americans to get out the vote. And Indian Country responded like never before. NCAI's civic engagement campaign, Native Vote, was the biggest, most successful in our 70-year history. A massive grassroots campaign deployed huge numbers of volunteers, young and old. They knocked on doors, registered voters, drove people to the polls, and helped turn out the highest number of Native voters ever. They did this even though our people still had unequal access to the polls. Too many Native voters travel long distances to exercise their right, only to be turned away. So even as we applaud the efforts of the 2012 Native Vote movement, we know this is just the beginning. And we have much more to do to ensure that every Native vote is cast and counted. Our commitment to democracy stretches beyond the ballot box to distant shores, where every day thousands of Native men and women fight proudly under the American flag. To the more than 22,000 active duty Native warriors, and to my more than 156,000 fellow Native veterans, I salute you. America salutes you. We're grateful for your service. Every day, in ways big and small, we're strengthening the unique nation-to-nation relationship tribes enjoy with the United States, a relationship of mutual respect, mutual obligation, and mutual trust. We've come a long way, but there's much more work to do, and I'm convinced now more than ever that we must protect and strengthen tribal sovereignty. That is how we will meet our three shared goals: to secure our communities, secure our nations, and secure our future. First, securing our communities. There's nothing more important to tribal leaders than the safety and well-being of tribal citizens. But today, one in three Native women will be raped in her lifetime. Almost 4 in 10 will be beaten and abused by a domestic partner. The death rate of Native women on some reservations is 10 times the national average. The numbers are so high as to be almost numbing. But here's the thing. Violence against women is not a cultural practice. It's a criminal practice. That's why we don't tolerate it. Tribes can and do pursue justice against Native men who commit these acts, but that's not enough. We know that assaults against Native women tend to take place at private residences, that many Native women live on tribal lands, that almost 60% of Native women are married to non-Native men. We know all this, yet we also know the tragic reality. Today, tribes do not have the authority to prosecute non-Natives who beat, rape, or even kill women on tribal lands. State and federal authorities are often hundreds of miles away without the local resources to investigate crimes. And in recent times, U.S. attorneys have declined to prosecute a majority of violent crimes in Indian country, most of which are related to sexual abuse. No other government would stand for this violation of sovereignty or continued injustice. No other government should, and no other government has to. The solution is simple. Congress must reauthorize the landmark Violence Against Women Act and assure that tribal governments have the authority to prosecute non-Native men accused of violence against women on tribal lands. In other words, Congress must allow tribes, like all other governments, to protect their own people and surrounding communities from brutality. So if we believe that a Native woman's life is worth the same as every other woman's, if we believe that justice should not stop at the border of a reservation, if we believe that tribes are truly sovereign, then it's time for the House of Representatives to step up, put partisan politics aside, and reauthorize the Violence Against Women Act with expanded protections for all victims of violence. Then we will join the people around the world in dancing in support of this movement. Congress has demonstrated that it understands the importance of tribal sovereignty. That's why in the 1970s they passed the Indian Child Welfare Act to ensure that tribal families have the ability to protect their children. It's why Congress recently authorized tribal leaders to directly seek a presidential disaster declaration, a critical tool for our governments to secure our communities. It's why the United States has joined more than 140 members of the United Nations in acknowledging that indigenous peoples are entitled to free, prior, and informed consent on decisions that affect our nations. This respect for our nation-to-nation relationship must extend to other issues that impact Indian country, including immigration. What many Americans may not realize is that almost 40% or 40 tribal governments are located on or near the borders of Mexico and Canada, which means tribes have jurisdiction over some of the areas most affected by immigration policy. These issues directly impact the lives of our citizens, and tribal nations must be at the table as the federal government considers common sense immigration reform. Tribes have faced new immigration for over 500 years, and we know it has its challenges. But to us, this isn't just a policy issue, it's a moral one. We firmly believe that the arc of justice must stretch from the first Americans to the newest Americans. As we continue to secure our communities, we also secure our nations. Our nations range from more than 200 remote Alaska Native villages to where tribal citizens make up 20% of the state's population, to the Navajo Nation in the Southwest with over 300,000 tribal citizens and a land base of 17 million acres. From Alaska to Arizona, California to Connecticut, tribal lands cover over 100 million acres, which would make Indian Country America's fourth largest state. This land is held in trust by the federal government. It was supposed to protect Indian land from both infringement and isolation. Unfortunately, that trust, our trust, was broken too many times. The funds used to maintain the trust were grossly mismanaged, not just once or twice, but over and over for decades and decades. It was a fraud that added up to billions and billions of dollars, an opportunity lost for generations of Native people. Last year, the federal government finally implemented the Cobell settlement to resolve the issue. While it doesn't erase the past or repair the damage, it does close a painful chapter in our history, and it turns a new page on our trust relationship. That relationship continues to grow. After 200 years of disputes, Recent settlements are securing tribal rights to water, which are critical to economic development for our communities, our livelihood, and people's health. Much more must be done to restore the trust relationship. The Carcheri Supreme Court decision overturned a long-standing precedent and threatens our economic future by limiting federal authority to acquire land in trust for Indian tribes. This cannot stand. Congress must pass a clean Carcheri fix right now. Our nations have enormous potential. Tribal lands boast almost 25% of America's onshore oil and gas resources and one-third of the West's low-sulfur coal. Yet they represent less than 5% of current national energy production. Why? Because of leasing restrictions. Fortunately, new federal policies are addressing this barrier, enabling tribes to develop their own sources of energy. The goal is to transform tribal lands and boost economic growth while contributing to America's energy independence. For instance, the Los Angeles City Council recently approved a 25-year, $1.5 billion project to buy solar power produced at the Moapa Band of Paiute Indian Nation in the southern Nevada desert. When it goes online in 2016, it will be the largest solar power plant on tribal lands, capturing the desert rays to power over 118,000 Los Angeles homes. In addition to the plant itself, over 900,000 solar panels will be built on the reservation, creating more jobs and industries of tomorrow. One way to ensure that we see more projects like this is to promote fair, equitable tax policy. Like all governments, tribes must be able to collect and manage their own taxes. But right now, tribal governments don't have the same taxing authority or ability as states, as local governments and the federal government. We will continue to working with our federal partners to fix these policies so that the economies of Indian country grow and become a source of strength in our family of nations. Tribal sovereignty is how we can secure our communities, it's how we can secure our nations, and is how we will secure our future. This is our greatest challenge. A quarter of our people live in poverty, twice the national average. And while the country as a whole struggles with an unemployment rate that hovers around 8%, the unemployment rate in Indian country is more than double that. Almost 1 in 5 Native people don't have basic phone service. And thousands more don't even have plumbing. For too long, these statistics have been accepted as the way it is in Indian country. The goal, it seemed, was survival. But we must do better. And when tribes can develop their own priorities and make the right investments, they don't just survive, they thrive. Throughout Indian country, from the Seminoles of Florida to the Tulalip in Washington, more and more tribes are driving economic growth for their nations and surrounding communities. Even in the most remote regions, tribes play a major role in promoting economic development. For example, the Tlingit and Haida tribes generate $31.5 million annually and is one of the top employers in Juneau in southeast Alaska, a huge boon to a region with limited economic activity. And, as I've said, many tribes are going global. The Suquamish tribe of Washington has lived on the central Puget Sound for thousands of years. Nobody knows how to fish those waters better than the Suquamish. Today, wearing the latest diving gear and armed with GPS devices, Native divers explore the icy waters to catch geoducks. What's a geoduck, you ask? The geoduck is the world's largest clam. More importantly, it's a delicacy in Chinese cuisine. The Suquamish formed a co-op with a number of tribes to export geoducks to Asian markets for as much as $50 per pound. It's an incredible example of how traditional knowledge is being applied in a new world. That's just one example. Multiply that entrepreneurship by hundreds of tribes growing, making, providing services, or selling products here and around the world, and it adds up to unprecedented progress and prosperity for our people. We'll continue doing our part to be proactive stewards of our own future. Rather than simply react to the federal government's actions, tribes are thinking, planning ahead, making decisions that allow us to withstand economic uncertainty. And it's paying off. Now, with the wind at our backs, we need the federal leaders to stand with us. With the right investments, tribal communities will continue growing stronger and advancing America's prosperity. We urge Congress to honor the trust responsibility by maintaining support for education, housing, roads, law enforcement, and energy development. The trust responsibility is not a line item, and we're not a special interest group. As budget discussions continue, we urge Congress to acknowledge their constitutional responsibility to honor our sacred trust by holding tribal governments harmless in the sequester and beyond. As President Obama said in the State of the Union address just 2 days ago, the federal government must keep the promises they've already made. Because this moment is about creating opportunity for our children and grandchildren. And with 42% of natives under the age of 25, we must take steps toward a stronger seventh generation. That's why Indian Country is investing in education so that more of our young people can receive a higher education and develop skills to access greater opportunities. Gaming, just one example of economic development, has generated funds for tribes to invest in schools and provide talented young Indians with scholarships. In fact, in the past 30 years, the number of American Indian and Alaska Native students enrolled in college has more than doubled. But we still have a long way to go. Today, NCAI is releasing a report called Securing Our Futures. It shows areas where tribes are exercising their sovereignty right now, diversifying their revenue base, and bringing economic success to their nations and surrounding communities. The path to securing our future, from education to food security, climate change to workforce development, is illuminated by the proven success of tribal nations. And while the circumstances of each tribal nation are unique, the promising practices contained in the report offer a way forward to secure tribal economies and sustain prosperity for future generations. In my final year as president of NCAI, I share this vision of a strong future for Indian nations, knowing that it will be carried forward not just in the year ahead, but for generations to come. When I look back on our journey as the first peoples of North America and where we are today, my heart fills with pride. We're on course to fulfill the promise of those who came before us, of our elders who preserved our cultures against all odds. It's because of their sacrifices that we stand strong today and strong forever. Our nations have been here a long time. We were a people before we the people. We engage in commerce. We shaped American democracy. And in some of America's darkest chapters, we stood with our non-native brothers and sisters. In the depths of the Depression, tribal nations rebuilt our communities. When our homelands were attacked, tribal warriors stepped forward, as they always have, to defend our shared sacred ground, the United States of America. For these reasons and so many more, tribal nations have been a wellspring of hope and strength to our fellow Americans. Indeed, our unique place in the American family of governments makes us a model for nations around the world and an inspiration to indigenous peoples across the globe. When I think about our shared future, I'm reminded of something the late Senator Daniel Inouye, a great American, once said to a gathering of tribal leaders, and I quote, "I can't think of anything, not anything, that is more critical to your past to your present or to your future than your sovereignty. Senator Inouye was not a native person. He didn't come from a tribal community, but he took up our cause and he spent his life advocating for our nations because he believed it was a matter of justice. He knew that America was at her strongest when all of her governments worked together to advance our security and prosperity. When all her people were thriving, he understood that a sovereign people are a strong people, contributing in turn to a strong United States. He knew that Native peoples were fighting for the same unalienable rights given to each of us by our Creator, the rights to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. These are the same principles that formed our treaties, and why our Constitution acknowledges tribes as equal, sovereign governments. Today, you can see that sovereignty in action in tribal courts, in the classrooms of tribal colleges, and in tribal businesses all over the world. This is the task at hand, to move together toward a more perfect union, to strengthen our trust relationship with the United States. From Washington to Kennedy, Reagan to Obama, tribal nations have worked with the United States to uphold this promise. That trust, ultimately, is a principle that must guide us, all of us, as we go forward and do right by all of our children and grandchildren. And when we do, we'll always be able to say that the state of Indian nations is strong and the future of and prosperity of America is secure. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Senator. Thank you. Now, it's my honor to introduce Senator Maria Cantwell. Senator Cantwell represents the great state of Washington, the home of the gooey ducks. She represents 29 tribes and almost 165,000 Native people. Senator Cantwell is one of the many Native vote success stories. She was elected in 2000 with strong tribal support, beating then Senator Slate Gordon by just 2,229 votes. She has served on the Indian Affairs Committee since her first year in the Senate. Throughout her service, she has worked to promote economic growth for Indian country and advance tribal sovereignty. Just last month, Senator Cantwell became the first female chair of the committee, and we're delighted to have her provide the congressional response to today's State of Indian Nations. Please join me in welcoming Chairwoman Maria Cantwell.
Well, thank you, President Keel, and thank you for that wonderful address and for your strong leadership at the National Congress of American Indians. I think you clearly laid out some of the biggest opportunities that we face working together in this new Congress. I see my colleague is here, the former chair of the Indian Affairs Committee, Senator Byron Dorgan. Thank you for your leadership in the past on the Senate Indian Affairs Committee. I'd like to say a special hello to the thousands of children who are watching throughout the country. You are the future leaders of our country, and we certainly need you. I'd also like to recognize two members of the National Congress of American Indians from my home state, Ron Allen, chairman of the Jamestown Sklallam Tribe, who is a treasurer of the National Congress of American Indians, and Fawn Sharp from the Quinault Nation, who is the Northwest Area Vice President. I know that both of them are strong members of NCAI, and I look forward to working with them in this new capacity. In his speech, President Keel spoke about Indian nations and their need to secure their futures. This reminds me of what Chief Seattle once said, quote, "The earth does not belong to us, we belong to the earth." Whatever befalls the earth befalls the sons and daughters of the earth. We do not weave the web of life. We are merely strands in it. And whatever we do to that web, we do to ourselves. From the first treaties with Indian nations, the federal government has acknowledged that Native people are the stewards of our land. Native people have lived off the land and in harmony with the earth and its resources for thousands of years. You have a strong voice that needs to be part of the national dialogue. And when it comes to seeking solutions, whether it's on natural resources or subsistence or climate change, we all need to work together. In President Obama's State of the Union speech this week, he said, quote, "The state of our nation is stronger. In many ways, we are able to say that the state of Indian country is stronger. Today, that is, than it was 50 years ago. Tribes have greater autonomy in managing their resources, preserving their cultures, and utilizing their land base. These accomplishments have come about for many reasons. One, we honor treaties. Two, we respect the government-to-government relationship. And we have grown together working to make sure that we can achieve all that is necessary. One of my goals as the chairwoman of the Senate Indian Affairs Committee is to make sure that Indian country grows even stronger. By working together with President Keel and other tribal leaders, we are going to work hand in hand to accomplish many things in 2013. I am so proud that just a few days ago, we were able to pass out of the United States Senate the Violence Against Women Act, with a very strong vote and a new tribal provision important to making sure that the federal government and tribal government work together to closely root out this issue of domestic violence on tribal reservations. And fortunately, we were able to defeat two very harmful amendments that would have watered down the rights of tribal women. And with a very strong vote of 78-22, we are now sending that legislation to the House of Representatives, and I call on them today to take immediate action to pass this important legislation. Passing the Violence Against Women Act out of the United States Senate, passing the Sandy Relief Bill with a particular tribal recognition in it, we have started 2013 on a good foot. But there is much work to be done in Indian country during this Congress. The Native American Housing Assistance Self-Determination Act expires this year. We have a farm bill that we need to reauthorize, the Elementary and Secondary School Act, which expired in 2008, is well past its due date for reauthorization. The issue of tax reform and making sure that the IRS deals with tribes in a fair way on tribal taxation issues. And we must address the 2009 Supreme Court decision, which affected tribes in its ability to take land into trust. For me, this issue is simple. I look at my home state of Washington, where Senator Danny Inouye and Congressman Norm Dix worked hard on a Puyallup tribe land claim settlement. With this act, the Puyallups gained the land and resources they needed to bring economic opportunity to the region. Now the Puyallup tribe is one of the largest employers in Pierce County with a payroll of over 3,500 people, 74% of them who are non-native. In the last year, I passed a land bill for the Quileute and Ho tribes so that they could move their school and people out of harm's way of a potential tsunami or the constant floods that were dealt with every single year. I'll never forget when I had one of the Quileutes testify before the Senate Indian Energy Committee. I asked them how close they were to the Pacific Ocean, and they said, well, sometimes it's right out the back door, and sometimes it's right under the window. I think that showed us that we needed to move them to a higher ground. So this issue of making sure that tribes can take land into trust, be part of communities for economic resources and their own well-being is an important, critical issue. Thank you. That's why I feel so strongly that Congress needs to pass a carcerary fix. This will be one of the top priorities for the Senate Indian Affairs Committee, and we have already begun work on it. When the National Congress of American Indians was established in 1944, it was to bring a voice to Native people and to enforce the treaties that had been signed. And these treaties live on in our relationship that is a tribal government to federal government relationship, which I say is a very mature relationship. It has built on these treaties, on our Constitution, and on federal law. President Keel stated that Indian country is strong. That is true, but it is only as strong as our leadership, and we need to continue that leadership. I would like to read part of a statement from a Skokomish leader. His name was George Adams, and he was an early leader in NCAI. Maybe some of you remember him. He was the first Native American legislator in Washington State. And at a 1951 convention, the National Congress of American Indians, he said the following, quote, "The 370 treaties which were compelled to sign and ratify are our tribal and legal inheritance. They represent the blood, the tears, and the lives of many ancestors, and they are the promissory notes for a great and strong nation. The subsistence of people say that those treaties were good for all mankind, and as long as the waters flow and the grass grows, and as long as the sun rises in the east and sets in the west, we are promised their substance, and they shall remain important to us," end quote. So he urged our fellow tribal leaders to guard them and protect them, to make sure that there was opportunity for the future. And so I'm asking us today, in 2013, to renew what that great tribal leader said from my state. I'm doing my part because it just so happens that his great-granddaughter, Mary Pavel, will be the staff director of the Indian Affairs Committee. So together, we will work to make sure that we honor these words of wisdom, get down to business, and do all we can for the next generation of Americans to make sure that they have the tools for economic opportunity for the future. In Washington State, our state motto is Alki. It's an Indian word that means hope for the future. Let's start off 2013 with much hope for the future. Thank you again for inviting me today.
At this time, we are open for questions and answers. We also will be taking questions from those that are on our web with my handy here iPad. And so we will go ahead and do that. So thank you for listening and being a part of the State of Indian Nations. And do we have any questions? Yes, President Garcia.
Thank you very much for the address of President Keel. It's an honor to be here.
We do need to
The question relates to water rights. We are going through a series of water rights litigation in the state of New Mexico now. The issues have come, and the states found a way out to get out of negotiating or even mitigating the water rights. That is that with the federal government and the changes in federal law, they're telling the state that they need to come up with 50% of the funding in order to make a settlement on water rights, whatever amount that is. And the state simply saying, well, if that's the case, case closed, because we ain't got the money. So what do Pueblos, in this case, do with a situation like that? It looks like the fix got to be here in Washington, D.C. Thank you.
Thank you. You know, I'm not sure what the answer is other than some type of federal legislation that would remedy that. I can tell you that we'll work hard with the Senate Committee on Indian Affairs and other our legislative associates and try to reach a remedy, but I'm not sure what the status of that would be. But that's certainly something we'll take up in our coming year. Thank you for that question. Let me just say that if you ask me a really hard question, something that I can't answer, I'm gonna turn to the encyclopedia here. So, thank you. Next question.
Do you want me to ask?
Sure.
Sure. I just wanted to be able to add a little bit on water rights. You know, of the 12 regions in the country, the Indian country's regions, 11 of those regions has made water issues one of their top priorities. So for Indian country, issues of water rights and safe water are all major issues. And we have been working with the various committees, but mostly important is to be that at the local level, that tribal governments are engaged when they have the discussions about water and they have water commissions and they're looking at allotments around water and agreements and compacts around water, that tribal governments are included at the table for those things. Other questions? Yes, over there in the corner. And we do have a microphone. If you could please announce yourself and who you're with.
My name is Sophia Resnick. I'm with the American Independent. And my question regards lack of access to phone service. I wanted to know how that issue is being addressed currently.
Okay.
Thank you for that question. You know, we do have a major initiative underway in Indian Country, working with the FCC, looking at other avenues and how we can rectify this. You know, when we talk about the great digital divide in Indian Country, there are regions across the country that simply do not have access to the grid, and we're working with FCC to get satellite communications up. I know that Jeffrey Blackwell works over at FCC, and he's done a lot of work in researching that and trying to get answers for us. But we are working and making progress with FCC on that initiative. Jackie, I'm not sure what you can add to that.
I think on two fronts. One is telephone penetration as well as just access to the technology, the broadband extensions that are in Indian Country. And both of them are critical. One, obviously, for safety and security reasons. We've been working with the various departments having to deal with making sure that we have access to 911. In fact, it was only a couple years ago, I remember, that the former chair of National Congress American Indian, Sue Mastin's tribe, actually finally got access to 911. And this is in California. It's not like it's, you know, some place that we normally hear about having trouble with telephone penetrations like Navajo or Alaska villages. And so we know that this is a prevalent problem, continues in Indian Country.
Anyone else?
Other questions? Yes, there in the back.
My name is Bryce Green. From the Southern Sierra Miwok, from Mariposa, California. We're not a federally recognized tribe, and I'm only 25. I did 5 years in the Marine Corps, Lance Corporal. I'd like to know, what is the process for federal recognition, and why haven't we had any help from this Indian National Congress for federal recognition, not for just for our tribe and other tribes that aren't federally recognized but state recognized? I'd like to see, hopefully, that, you know, there's leadership from the Congress and from other tribes can help federally recognize. I'm sorry that it's all coming at once, but yes, thank you.
You know, that's a great question, and I want to thank you for that. Let me just state that, number one, NCAI is an inclusive organization. The National Congress of American Indians does not exclude any tribal government. We realize that there are tribes that have, some have been recognized and terminated by the federal government. There is a federal recognition process that tribes go through to become or to gain that federal recognition or to be recognized by the federal government. Some of these tribes have gone through the state through the process and are recognized by their state governments. Now, it's a very difficult process. It's a tenuous process, the federal recognition policy I'm talking about. But there is a process. NCAI does support that process. We encourage tribes to apply and go through that process. But it is very difficult and it is very tenuous. But I can just tell you that we are working on that. We have a federal recognition task force at NCAI that works specifically on that issue. There are members here within the audience I know that serve on that task force, and I know that they'll be glad to meet with you at the conclusion of this to maybe offer direction or assistance, but we're obviously willing to help. Thank you.
And I'd like to take a question now from one of our online viewers, Mark Trahant, who, of course, is a well-known journalist for Indian Country. His question is, friends in Congress support Indian programs, but not Medicaid, a funding source that is growing. How do we get them to look at the big picture?
Well, Medicaid and Medicare is one of those issues, a very sensitive topic in America, not just in Indian Country, but Medicaid is a state program. It's not a federal program. The Medicare program obviously is. I know that Secretary Sebelius has encouraged states to get on board and work with tribes to develop a policy. And on the next week, there will be some consultations with CMS and others to talk about specifically about Medicaid and how it is implemented. With the Affordable Care Act, and I know we have an expert here in the audience today to talk about the Affordable Care Act and the Indian Health Care Improvement Act, sometimes those provisions don't necessarily line up, and so Medicaid is one of those that we'll continue to work with. The state exchanges and the federal exchanges will work together to eliminate a lot of the barriers that Indian people will see in registering and becoming eligible and accessing the Medicaid program. But we're working on that. I know that it's a difficult process right now. I know that Secretary Sebelius has indicated her support for Medicaid, and she's encouraged the states to get on board and work with the tribes.
Okay, other questions? I know we have one over here. Tom, I thought you said right. Oh, right there. Sorry.
Peter Granitz with Alaska Public Radio. Mm-hmm. I'm curious about if NCAI is working with tribes and IHS facilities to prepare for sequester, and if so, what specifically are you doing?
Well, if everyone could start a little bit by talking about sequester, yes. You know, one of the things originally we had thought that the IHS facilities were actually going to be exempt from sequester, but later on found out that was not interpreted the way that we thought that it was interpreted. And so, like IHS facilities, we have one of the things in our securing our futures, we do talk to tribes about things that they need to do, give them examples of what some other tribes have done to be able to actually in their own communities address some of the challenges during economic challenging times. But we also are working with Congress to try to be able to address this protections, because it's not just IHS facilities, although that's really critical for our law enforcement, for our healthcare, but it's our law enforcement officers, it's our education systems that are all dependent upon these federal resources to maintain. And we don't want to be closing our schools or turning away our law enforcement officers and not be able to heal our sick and deal with the critical issues if we don't address sequester. We have a budget book, we have a budget briefing document that is part of the press kits. We have it online. We've been very aggressive, and we hope people help us with doing that. But we do encourage tribes too. On that note, we've been talking with tribes a lot about things like lean management, how to be able to take on some of those principles and really scale to the ways to address our most critical needs and be efficient and effective with the use of federal funds that we do have in our communities.
Let me just say, as a tribal leader, the sequester, in real terms, will affect tribal communities all the way down at the clinical level. It will affect whether or not a young mother may or may not be able to access health care for her unborn child. it will access whether or not elderly people will be able to afford their medications or afford to go to the doctor. It will affect human lives all the way down to the community level, not just in Washington, D.C., not just in the urban areas, but everywhere across America. So the sequester, in my mind, is it necessary? You know, tribal governments, tribal leaders across this country, we understand that America needs a more efficient, smaller, more efficient government. We don't argue that point. What we are concerned with is when you look across the board at these cuts and you take a percentage, regardless of what it is, whether it be 6, 8, 10% of the funding that provides for the health care, education, the very quality of life that our people are enjoying today. And some people in some places, they're struggling already. It will even worsen that. So in my mind, or as tribal leaders have said, not just in my mind, I'll agree with the tribal leaders that have come forward already. We've asked that the federal government exempt tribal governments and tribal health care facilities and our programs from the sequester. We'll work with our congressional leaders, and we'll work with the federal government and our federal partners in every way that we can to make sure that we're doing things more efficiently and more expeditiously to provide for those services. But we can't afford those types of services cuts across the board in Indian country. We're talking about the poorest of the poor, and we can't afford that. So we're asking, once again, the federal government to exempt tribal nations from the sequester cuts. Now, I know that may not sound as simple as, you know, but in our mind it is simple. But thank you. Next.
We have a question over here. No? Okay. All right. I have another question on the line here. Given the conversation about sovereignty in the speech, Tracy Morris asked the question, what role does nation building play as an exercise of sovereignty?
Nation building.
Nation building. That means acting, exercising sovereignty.
Nation building. That's a good term. Thank you, Tracy, for that question. When we talk about sovereign nations, when we talk about exercising our sovereign rights, sovereignty is not something, first of all, we need to understand what sovereignty is, what it really means. Sovereignty is not something that tribal nations were granted by the federal government of the United States of America. Our sovereign status was recognized and affirmed in the Constitution of the United States. So it's a constitutional thing. And our rights as sovereign nations allow us to determine our own futures. It allows us to not just build our own communities, but develop our own resources, manage our own resources, everything from our land, our people, our resources. When we talk about the natural and human resources. And one of the most precious cultural resources is our children and preparing for our children's future. So we must determine what our community needs are. Tribal leaders, tribal nations are more than qualified to do that. They're more than capable of doing that. They've been doing it since time immemorial. We simply need the federal government to stand with us and support us in that endeavor. And we can do that. So when we talk about nation building, we simply want to continue to enable our tribal governments and our tribal communities to seek and reach that same level of, independence. Not just financial independence, but we want to live as independent people, just like everyone else in America. Thank you.
Okay, I have another question, and this one comes through our Facebook. We have lots of people watching in different ways. This is from Chuck Sams. What incentive does BIA really have to ensure the Cobell funds are spent down for fractionated land purchases within the 10-year time frame?
Read that again.
What incentive does BIA really have to ensure that the Cobell funds are spent down for fractionated land purchase within the 10-year time frame? Do you want me to answer that?
Yeah.
All right. So within the Cobell settlement, there was a variety of things put in place. But one of them, and one of the most important things to Indian country, was it allowed for the repurchase back of fractionated lands so that we could solidify the land base in our tribal communities. And the Department of Interior is readily moving forward to move that initiative forward. We've actually, at NCAI, we've actually met with the special master that's actually helping to organize some of the payment options in Cobell. But I think one of the most important incentives in there is, as they put together that fractionated land, portions of that money actually builds a trust fund, a scholarship program, an initiative for future generations. And so it's important to Indian country. It's like a balancing piece, and it brings together a little bit of bringing together the tribal communities through the land purchases and repurchasing, but it also then is an incentive to Indian country to allow for this to move forward so that we can build that base for scholarships for our future generations, for the seventh generations to come.
Let me just add one thing. When you talk about what the incentive does BIA have, I'm not sure that they need an incentive other than it's contained in the law. And that's what the law says that they must do. So they don't really have a choice in this matter. It's a matter that they simply need to do what they're told and assist tribes. This allows tribes to repurchase those lands that were fractionated, so the tribes can then take those lands and use those for their best efforts, whether it be for economic development or for housing, for healthcare facilities, or whatever it is. They can use those lands for their communities. Okay, next.
And we have a question over here.
Boa from Associated Press. I was wondering if you can tell me how many votes you have in the House to get VAWA through. How many do you lack? How short are you of Republican votes to get that through, or Democrat either way? And can you tell me, based on the negotiations that you had late last year, the efforts with Eric Cantor, et cetera, what's the sticking point? I've heard people raise the constitutional issue, but I've also heard people easily dismiss that as well.
Well, they've raised a constitutional issue, but I believe that I know that Congressman Tom Cole has—he's certainly answered that question of whether or not it's constitutional or not—and he's done a very good job of educating his fellow constituents on the constitutionality of the question regarding the votes, number of votes. I'm not sure where we are. I know Jackie's worked very closely with that, so Jackie.
You know, we're constantly counting votes, so I can't give you my vote count at this moment in time. But we know that we have the sponsors of the former Isa Cole amendment that I believe co-sponsors. We're looking for more co-sponsors at this very moment. We have the Republican leadership that sent the letter to their leadership saying that a VAWA bill must pass, including the tribal provisions. We believe that those are good, strong supporter for us. We have a number of Democratic members of Congress, and certainly, you know, Congresswoman Betty McCollum was here earlier helping to lead the charge to be able to make sure that we have the Democratic support similar to the support that we had in the Senate. And, you know, our job as advocates in D.C. is to really be able, and tribal leaders across the country, is to be able to make sure that we continue to increase those numbers so that the showing that we had in the Senate for the tribal provisions will prevail in the House. And as President Keel said, definitely one of the questions is really in how do we, I guess for me, it's a challenging question, because the tribal courts, our tribal courts, many of our tribal courts look just like other people's courts. And in the bill, we put protections in that bill. We put protections so that even though we have the Indian Civil Rights Act, that there is a jury of their peers. We put in the protections to be able to make sure that if a tribe takes on these responsibilities to have a non-Native in their court systems under the Violence Against Women Act, that they would have indigenous defense. We made sure that there was a test, that it's not just a non-member coming into our communities and having this act, taking upon this act of violence, but it is someone who is chosen to live in our communities, who is living with a member of our community, who lives and works there on a regular basis, and that they have agreed to live within that community, and so there's some implied consent. Those are the things that we know that are already in the bill, the protections, and we believe that those things addressed any questions that they may have. We'll continue to work with the members of the leadership and in the House to be able to refine the bill, to make it into a point that's important, that so it can get passed. But it's really important to us that our sovereignty is recognized, and that our tribal systems are recognized, and that we can address perpetrators in our community that violate our women and our children. Characterize the gap. You know, there's a gap. I'll just say there's a gap, but I'm actually very confident that our gap is not is closing, and our gap is not unachievable. I believe with the strong leadership that we have with folks like Congressman Don Young and Tom Cole and Congressman Issa, and you know, the list goes on of folks who support us, that their leadership will stand firm on this issue. I believe if we go to a vote on this issue in the House, we will win.
Is that it?
Oh, we have another, yes.
Justin Kay from the WINS program. Sticking with the role of exercising our sovereign rights, how do you feel the effectiveness of tribal government health care compares with IHS direct government care?
Let me just tell you, let me just state this, that it's obvious that self-determination works. You know, when we talk about self-governance, and the ability of tribes to contract or operate their own healthcare programs, the success of that cannot be disputed. We have over 331 or 32 tribes that are self-governing tribes now that operate their own healthcare facilities, or at least parts of those facilities, their programs. I can give you an example of self-determination or self-governance and how it works. In 1994, or prior to 1994, the Chickasaw Nation had an Indian healthcare hospital, an IHS hospital. All of our care was direct service tribe. I mean, we were a direct service tribe. It was directly provided by the Indian Health Service. And quite frankly, it was unacceptable. You know, it didn't mean it wasn't good care and quality care. It just simply means that it was not being operated the way we felt like it should. So my tribe, the Chickasaw Nation, we contracted that facility, the hospital, and that grew into operating the entire healthcare program. We changed the philosophy of just outpatient care to a family practice care, where we had a doctor, a medical doctor, who establishes a relationship with a patient and their family, so that they could see the same doctor over and over again, not, you know, take a chance on a contract doctor from somewhere. And it changed the complete look and feel of our health care. The quality of our health care just rose quickly. Now it's one of the best health care programs across the country anywhere. And we'd compare that with anywhere, particularly when you talk about the quality of health. It's not just the quantity of health that we receive, it's a quality. And so when you look at a tribe being able to operate, with the question we used to ask ourselves was, who would you rather have making a decision on your health care priorities? Your tribal government or some bureaucrat in Rockville, Maryland? No offense. You know, but if you think about it, we understand how to operate our programs. Tribes have proven that they can, and they do. Tribes have proven over the years, for centuries, for hundreds of years, that we can do more with less. And so just quite simply, tribes have proven that they can operate their health care facilities, their programs, because they're closer to the people. They understand the needs, and they understand, and they care personally about that. They're personally engaged with those patients. Thank you.
We have time for one more question, and I'm going to take it from the web. Do you have a comment on NCAI's position on Canada's First Nation and Idle No More?
Sure. Earlier this year, we NCAI issued a statement that we stand with the Assembly of First Nations, our brothers and sisters, and our federal tribal governments in Canada. And in that statement, we said that because there's a border, this invisible line that separates the two nations, we didn't create that line. And some of our people live on both sides of that border. We support their right to self-governance. We support their right to engage in the nation-to-nation relationship with the Canadian Parliament. There's a little bit difference in how NCAI and the Assembly of First Nations, although we mirror each other in a number of ways, the Assembly of First Nations have a direct relationship because they receive funding and support from the Canadian Parliament. National Congress of American Indians does not. We're an organization made up voluntarily of tribal governments across this country that come together for a common purpose. But we support their issues. We support them in their desire to become more self-sufficient and to have this nation-to-nation relationship with their federal government. But we're not saying that we're different. We have different issues and different different directions. But we do support the Canadians and our brothers and sisters and the Assembly of First Nations.
Thank you. I'd like to thank those who have sent their questions online, and rest assured that we will answer them, Zach and others, questions I didn't get to. And I'd like to thank all of you for listening and being part of the annual State of Indian Nations Address. On behalf of the National Congress of American Indians, I'd like to thank Native Voice One, the tribal and public radio stations across the country, their online viewers at ncai.org for realizing the importance of covering this event today. Gunashchish, thank you.
Good job.